there were so many people that saw the first debate and just felt the sense of shame for the country, that it represented the worst of us and not the best of us. What do you say to those who are concerned about the soul of America? Like, on that spiritual level, is there really hope? Is there turning this thing around? What do you see from, you know, a spiritual level?
I think that there is hope. I think that there definitely is hope, but I think that the soul of America is at stake right now. When Common started talking about leadership, I almost leaped out of my seat, because what we're seeing is the death of leadership. And in order to get great leadership, you may have to vote across parties. You may have to get this one from this side and that one from that side. I'm not going to tell you who to vote for, but I am going to tell you what good leadership looks like. Good leadership has class. It has respect. It has order in its ranks. It gets things done. It minimizes drama. We have had so much drama every day. There has been so much drama that it's going to take years for us to work through this post-traumatic stress disorder. When you look at the deaths, when you look at the virus, when you look at the unrest, when you look at the political unrest, what happened on that stage that night was a picture of what's been happening in this country. For the last few years, we have been at each other's throat. And it just epitomized where our country is right now. And our enemies are listening. A lot of times when Black people start talking about voting, we always focus on domestic issues, but we need to also think about international issues, because we have international enemies that will wipe out the whole domestic discussion. It won't be about police brutality. It won't be about anything else. They will take the whole thing away from us. And the enemy looks for an opening. And bad leadership leaves openings. It creates chaos, it leaves openings, it spreads confusion, and it appeals to the worst in humanity better than the best in humanity. But I believe that there are enough good people and great people who really care. You don't have to be perfect to be a good person, who really care about this country and care about our future and care about our children, that I think that they're going to speak in this election. They're going to rise up and they're going to really reflect the better part of ourselves. And I'm calling on our better angels to rise up and speak from every spectrum of life, Black, white, red, brown, blue. I don't care what color you are. If you care about what I care about, if you care about having a safe place for your grandchildren, if you care about justice and liberty for everybody and not just for a few, if you care about opportunities that are preparing for the future, When I go into other parts of the world, I realize how far behind we are slipping. You know, when you go into places like Dubai and you see how far ahead they are with technology and innovation, America likes to tout that we're ahead. Listen, we are not ahead. In the educational system, we're number 25 across the world. We are not ahead. Economically, we're in debt up to our ears. Oh. We are not ahead. We couldn't even come up with our own ventilators. We are not ahead. When you look at the situation we're in right now, we are in a crisis. And it is the kind of crisis that all of us can feel every day. When you take the global crisis and then the national crisis, and then you add your own personal life crisis, there's going to be stress from this for years to come. Mm-hmm. Now add the people who are losing their jobs, the marriages that are imploding. As a pastor, I'm on ground level zero. We are the people who bury the dead. We are the people who get the calls in the middle of the night with people screaming. We are the people who are there in the cemeteries. We are there when people stop by on the way to the divorce court. Believe me, the trauma that's going on in this country right now, irrespective of race, it's so dynamic. What we need is good leadership in every aspect. You might not agree with every policy and every issue and every decision, but I think we need to define what good leadership looks like, because some of us didn't see it in our home. Mm-hmm. Some of us didn't see it in our school, and we don't know what good leadership looks like. So we pick people by silly stuff. We pick people because they look nice. We pick people because they sound nice. Look at how they lead, how they organize their people. Are you getting mixed messages from the leadership, from inside the leadership rank? Are you getting four or five different messages, don't know what to think? That's a sign you got bad leadership. Mm. And we need to change that.
Can I expound on what the bishop said, Natasha? First of all, I love Bishop T.D. Jakes. He knows that. I watch Bishop every Sunday morning. So he's a true leader to me. I love Bishop. But I agree with what you said, Natasha. That on that stage the other night, that was the worst of us. And I feel like the worst of us has always been old white males in positions of power. I truly believe that. Like, and I feel what the bishop is saying, I feel like it is the death of a leadership. And I think patriarchy in this country has limited our leadership. Like, we need to give some other races and genders an opportunity to lead. I also think that the two-party system is dead. We have let two sets of ideologies lead us for far too long in America. And America's way more diverse than that. So yes, I agree it's bad leadership. And in this case, to me, it's old white male leadership that needs to die, because they designed this country, this system, and they weren't thinking of anybody on this call that looks like us. They weren't thinking of any people that look like us when they designed this system.
But my question is, and Bishop Jakes, you're absolutely right, and Charlamagne, I mean, this call, it's an amen corner call, I guess. It's a family call. Bishop Jakes, you're right. You know, when there is a breach, a tear in the fabric of this nation, the coming together, the unification of a nation, it leads to a national security issue. And that's real. And that's when other countries can find our weakness and come in. And that is real. We are in the midst of a crisis, and let's define the crisis, a national security crisis. That's real. And then on top of that, when you have the racial reckoning, communities fighting against each other, that's one piece of the national security crisis. Two, when you have a pandemic and the mismanagement, and now the president is sick, that's another piece of the national security crisis. And then you have people questioning the sacredness of the political system, our dynamic of voting. This is when another country can swoop in and do something unfathomable. So Bishop Jakes, you are always on the money. And going back to Charlamagne, I'm tired of saying, you know, leadership here, leadership there. When are we going to take ownership of what Shirley Chisholm says, the first Black woman to run for president in 1972? Charlamagne, and you know this, she said, if you don't have a seat at the table, bring a folding chair. I don't want to use the folding chair. I want to learn the game and own the game. I want to own the table and the chairs, put a couple of leaves in the table. So to bring other people there. So I'm tired of saying, you know, it's their game. When are we going to jump in to own the system? I'm just tired of hearing, you know, we gotta. We need to just say, here, I'm here. I want to learn how to play the game, because they've kept us out from the game. Now we are allowed to get in. Now it's time for us to own it.
Now I was gonna say, can we get in and play by their rules and still win?
Oh yeah. You get in, play by their rules, and then you go out and branch off and create the game yourself. There are so many. Byron Allen, right here on the thing. All right,
Byron.
Hello. That's what I'm saying. Tyler Perry. Hello. Yes. Oprah. I'm just talking media people. We got other people out here. Bishop Jakes is not just a pastor, but he is an entrepreneur. Common is not just a rapper. He is an entrepreneur. He is there. Each one of us individually. You have your own. You've got your own projects. So this is what I'm saying. We have to stop feeling like we have to go by everybody's system. Let's learn. Let's play their game and beat them at their game. That's what I'm saying. I'm tired of saying, oh, well, I'm tired of this. Let's lead, instead of saying I'm tired of them leading. Let's just start leading.
Yeah.
The opening is there.
And Common, where have you seen moving the ball forward? Because you have been helping the most disenfranchised folks who were parolees, you know, people who have been in jail, who they want to give up. They don't want them to go to the polls or feel like they can. What type of organizing have you done, and where have you seen some wins that you're like excited about?
Well, with the prison work that we've done, I did a lot of work in California with this organization called ARC and Imagine Justice. And, you know, we went there and just was building, sitting there listening to brothers and sisters talking, just to see. I'm the type of person, like, when I do some work, I don't think I can go into a community and just come with my ideas. I gotta really hear what the people need more than anything. So that was my first step, right, to go into the prisons and just build with women and men and hear where they were and hear what they needed. We eventually were able to go out and do concerts at all these prisons. Like, we did over like 12 prisons in California, and we ended up doing a concert at the Capitol in Sacramento where J. Cole performed with us and Andrew Day performed with us. And we had like, we ended up having 30,000 people. Now, the next day we went and sat with legislators and it was a bill called SB 394, which was helping to get young men and women who were sentenced to life without parole. We basically wanted to stop that. If you were under 18 and you've been arrested for even a violent crime or whatever, you can't just be, because we met so many people who were serving life without parole. They, you know, and it just was like, we want to change the situation. Juveniles, I mean, there's been studies showing that when you're 16, 18, your brain is not developed yet. We saw how much trauma a lot of people in prison and, you know, who were committed eventually transferred into more crime. So we were like just basically trying to stop that situation. We sat down and met with legislators. Boom. It was people who wasn't on our side. Eventually just sitting down with them and inviting them to the prisons to see what was up, and them sitting down talking to people who were incarcerated. That was the real game changer. Like, and eventually we got SB 394 and SB 395 passed. And it's no longer you can do life without parole if you're a juvenile in the state of California. And for me, you know, we could talk about any awards or whatever, but that is definitely one of the things that is I've been most proud of, where I can like be like, man, I'm actually part of like somebody's life being changed. Like I can see it tangibly. And and you know, just to actually correlate that to some offset from me goes, we working on this thing called Urgency 2020, where we doing what we talking about, we're going and educating people about, you know, who's running down the ticket. And he was telling me a story about how, you know, he had got arrested and he didn't think he could vote. But when he found out he could vote, it was just like a game changer. And he said this to us and brought tears to our eyes, really. He was like, man, out of any award I've got, he said that voter sticker was more important than any award I got. And it was just like, my thing was, what we did, I hope, and I hope that we continue to do, is our people that's usually the most looked at low, like people in prison I looked at as low criminals. Oh, you committed this crime, you've committed murder, and there's no forgiveness or rehabilitation or redemption or healing. We want to look at them and make sure that they coming out and being able to vote. Because you, as you said before, Byron, in Florida, if those brothers who have been released, who had come out of prison, would have been able to vote, Andrew Gillum would have been in there. So we, you know, we just working to get people their rights. I mean, Bishop Jakes know from the scripture, man, it's like, if you, when you look out for those who are incarcerated, those who are poor, you're looking out for God, out for God's children. So that's the work we've been striving to do.
Yeah. With our last 10 minutes, I really just want you to talk directly to our audience. So if each of you could just offer your perspective on, we got 4 weeks. I mean, this thing is right around the corner. We are exactly a month away. What do you tell people to keep their eyes on the prize? Because Charlamagne, we were talking about October's the prize. You know, there's always something to distract us. People are tired. They want to check out. They don't want to talk about the state of the world, or they do. You know, how do we keep our eyes on the prize for the next month? So what is your wish to our GRIO family?
Man, it's a lot, right? My wish is that we continue to operate in our own Black gifts, you know, because I read something yesterday and it was like, you know, you don't have to be at the head of the table, because when you operate in your own gifts, wherever you sit or stand, the table will shift. And I think that's what we are now, because Black people are unapologetically showing up as themselves in all spaces. And, you know, we're not trying to, you know, go along just to get along or play the game, so to speak. Like, we're telling America, you know, the way this system has been doing things is wrong and we're not standing for it anymore. So just showing up as ourselves is shifting things. And I guess that's the most important thing for the next 30 days, regardless of what distractions happen, we're going to have to show up on November 3rd, right? And I want people to realize too, like, you know, even when we get Biden and Harris in the White House, America is not going back to whatever perceived normal we were used to. Like, that's over. Like, America is never going back to normal. The other side of America, for both sides, has been exposed forever. No rose-colored glasses like when President Obama was in the White House. We are never going backwards. Like, the true realities of what America really is has been exposed. And that's why, even if Biden and Harris get in the White House, and I don't want to say even if, when they get in the White House, we have to keep our foot on their neck, so to speak, and make sure they are in there working for us and the others in this country who really need it.
April, you want to go next?
Sure. I think we need to stop really being intimidated by the process. Going back to what Charlamagne and Common were saying, we have to find, if we don't know, don't be afraid, don't be embarrassed, reach out. Because there's so much, once again, at stake. Everything that is about us is on this ballot. Politics is personal. It's about you. Everything. And if it's not today, it will be tomorrow, some kind of way. And I think, again, we need to find the people who we trust, who we believe reflects our value system or reflects who we are, our existence, and listen to them. And then take the onus and go to their platform and look at everything, every issue. And if you have to pick up the phone or Google them and email them, do it and get a response. Hold them accountable because they want your vote. But at the end of the day, as I said before, it's too precious to throw away. We have to vote. And I encourage everyone to vote early. What's taken normally 2 days to go through the mail takes 3 weeks or a month. Go call the Board of Election Supervisors in your community and make sure you're registered, and then get that ballot and then send it back in the ballot box. If you can walk away from using the Postal Service, please do. Right now, we're in the midst of voter suppression 2020. We have got to overcome. And I think about, again, and Common, you on here, all I keep thinking is about is glory and how I jump over the moon over that. That's like our fight song. I mean, that is like a spiritual awakening for us. 1965, the Edmund Pettus Bridge, all of that, broken, bruised, and died for this right. And they're trying to do the same thing in a different way in 2020. Prove them wrong and go vote. Make your vote count.
Yes.
Well, amen. Common?
Yeah, well, I mean, what April said is like, to continue that, like, they've been doing this for a long time, but this is a time where we actually had a renewing and a rebirth going on right now. And all the trauma we've been through, and like the mentality of, man, this system ain't never did nothing for me. We see it right in front of us, what can be done. It's right there, it's right in front of us. Like, and it's people telling you that you trust, and you can hold us accountable. You got people like Charlamagne is a leader in the world. Bishop Jakes is a leader in the world. Byron, April, we leaders. Y'all hold us accountable. We sitting there up here telling you to vote. If these people don't show up for you, which we are, we're gonna hold them accountable anyway. The people that we saying like go out and vote for, like, we holding them accountable. And there's people out here that truly do represent you. Use your discernment too. Use your discernment, man. We all got the God in us to make the decisions. Man, just look at the people running. Do your diligence, man, because this is affecting our lives. It's like, as we talked about leadership, it's like, man, when you live in a house with good parents, you don't think about certain things because it's just going well. But you know, when you're in a house with destructive parents, it just causes a tension and a negativity and negative energy. And we've been having destruction for a long time, even when it was hitting. This is one opportunity where, as Charlamagne said, it ain't no going back. This is one opportunity where we actually have a chance to go forward like we never have before. So I just ask of each person to just be responsible for yourself, for your loved ones, for your community, and for the people. If you stand for the people in any way possible, the people, then you got to vote and help hold everybody accountable.
Yes, I love it. I love it. You know, this, you know, I've interviewed a lot of folks, and one of the interviews that sticks with me is an interview I did with the great athlete Carl Lewis, who won 9, you know, gold medals. And I remember asking him, you know, great track star, track and field star. I said, do you ever, you know, look back? Do you ever, when you start that race, do you ever, you know, kind of get a glimpse of, you know, look back and see how far ahead you are? And he said, no. He said, I focus on one thing. I focus on making sure that my body is doing what I'm supposed to be doing. And if my body is doing what it's supposed to do, then I know everybody is behind me. Mm. And I don't have to look back. And this voting and donating is just part of the process. And what I say to my people, what I say to Black America, you have to remember our unique relationship with America. We are the only people who were brought here to make white America wealthy. And when we were brought here, we were considered assets, and they measured their wealth by how many slaves they had, not how much land. And when we were their slaves, we were their assets. And the moment we were freed, we became, in their minds, a liability. And that's when they started murdering us and lynching us and burning us and blowing up our towns and incarcerating us, because it was less about the color of our skin and more about the money and the power. And they didn't want to share any of that economic power with us. There was no inclusion whatsoever. So this is part of the process of making sure we're running the perfect race and everybody's behind us. This is just one part of it, because Black America, let me be clear, you are positioned to fail. We have been positioned to fail since the day they brought us here over 400 years ago. I know for a fact we are positioned to fail. When people talk about my company, the thing that's amazing is that for the first 15, 20 years of my company, I couldn't get a bank loan. And I had to pay factors 27% interest to factor the best receivables in the world. And we are positioned to fail. So what do we have to do? We have to unlock that matrix. We have to not only vote, we have to donate, and we have to vote and donate up and down the ticket. And when we do get these politicians in power so we can run the perfect race, we have to say, I need you to make sure that our kids are properly educated. My mother had me 17 days after her 17th birthday. What changed the trajectory of our lives? She got into UCLA film and TV, and she got a master's in cinema and television. That changed the game. Every American needs to have an opportunity to access the best education. Hey, politician, I need you to make sure that Black Americans are getting access to capital that's not predatory. Hey, politicians, I need you to make sure that the government is supporting us. And yes, we do need reparations. We have a $1 trillion government worker pension fund. Black people don't participate in any of it. I'm not participating in the political process just to see someone in. I'm participating in the political process to say, this is my agenda. And my agenda is to make Black America better and to position Black America to succeed and not fail. My agenda is to put politicians in place so I can help stop the genocide against Black America. And when we vote and when we donate, this is just one part of running the race, of making sure everybody's behind us. It's just part of the process. So we have to do it. And we have to do it now. We have to do it early. This is how we stop genocide, because you are living in genocide against Black America. And you do it by being a part of the process. And I'm really speaking to young Black men. You got to be a part of the process. And when we get them in power, we control the process. You can hold them accountable and say, if you want to stay there, you need to protect and support and position Black people for success. It's a simple concept. That's what has to happen.
Thank you, Byron. And the wise Bishop. Bishop, can you give us a final word as we go on with this month ahead? It's just a month. It's right around the corner.
I'm thinking about how odd it is, out of everybody on the panel, I'm the only one with gray hair.
I'm letting mine come in.
That's why I'm bald. I'm gonna be honest with you. Trust me, I look like Santa Claus. I got it.
Yeah, it is. Definitely.
You're not alone.
I don't know when it turned white. It turned white overnight, and yet, in spite of the whiteness of my hair, I want to talk to the young people. Everything is about you. It's all about you. You are the most important person in the room. Please hear me. What you kill in your youth, you eat in your senior years. Hmm. if you don't get it now, it will not happen. Not the now of the moment that you're worried about, where you're blinging and you're showing off you're this and you're that and the other. You got to have a strategy that protects your later years. What we are talking about when we're talking about voting, it's going to affect you more than anybody to reimagine your world and recreate your world, because you're going to rest in what is being created right now. And because you can more safely get in to vote than we can or anybody else can, we are passing the baton to you. Do not drop this ball. Get out and vote. Your old person, your old man that's in you, that old woman that you will become later, will thank you if you take action right now. And if you cut back just a little bit on being important right now, you can be great for a lifetime. But I appeal to you today to take this opportunity and seize it, because it is your children that are in school. Mine are grown. It is your children that'll be drinking that bad water. It is you, it is your building years, your developing years, your home ownership years. This is the time for you to wake out of your sleep. And now more than ever, you say, it's my turn, it's my turn. Here it is, take it, vote. Give, donate, even if it's $10, if it's $15. You know why? Because they're going to look at who supported the campaign, and that's whose calls they're going to take first. They're not going to take your call because you're mad. They're going to take your call because you supported them. And I want to challenge you on your level to take this chance right now and stand up and create the world you want your children and your children's children to live in.
Amen.
Benediction now.
That's it, right there. Family.
Benediction.
Thank you so much. April, thank you. Common, thank you so much. Charlamagne, thank you. Mr. Allen, of course, thank you. And Bishop T.D. Jakes, thank you so much. You could have been anywhere on this day, but you were with us, with our GRIO family. GRIO family, please hit share at the bottom of this video and make sure that the people in your family, in your community, hear this important message. Register to vote, help people get out to vote, and show up before or on November 3rd. Remember the power that you have. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks for having us.
Y'all have a blessed day.